Hi, my name is Tom, and you are at level number 11 of 30 easy steps to understand everything about Einstein's special relativity. This level is about James Clerk Maxwell and his equations. It will be a summary of all the previous levels, and I will refer to them when needed. It's the first, I would say, plateau. Is that an English word? Plateau on Einstein's mountain. Once we've covered this, you can relax and enjoy the view. I mean, Maxwell's equations are so big and so beautiful that even people tattooed these equations on their body. So, if you want to know all about these equations, let's get into it. GP, hit it! As said, all previous 10 levels led us to here. Let's review them from the start. So in level number 1, I gave an introduction on the 30 levels, and I told you the secret of Einstein's special relativity is on top of the mountain. And you can either climb, or you can do a touristic tour, or you can take the middle way, and that is walk the mountain. Many steps, but every step is doable. And here we are, climbing Einstein's mountain, which is really great. We talked about algebra. We had to, you know, but I tried to make it as easy and fun as possible. Vectors. Calculus. Oh, yes, we did calculus. We talked about the electrostatic force of Coulomb in level number 6. Then a very big mathematical piece, which was difficult, right? The dot product, the cross product, divergence and curl. Next, we went to meet Gauss and his law on electric flux. Level 9 was about Hans Christian Ørsted, who first saw that magnetism and electricity are joined and not two separate domains in physics. And last level, we talked about Faraday's law of induction in 1831. And these all come together in Maxwell's equation. So here we are after this level. You can enjoy the view. You can relax and recover before we will move on. So Maxwell's equations, they are great. They really are. Remember, this journey on our mountain, it's a marathon, right? It's not a sprint. As said, I tried to make every step doable. And sometimes I introduced difficulty levels where you can go to the next level if you only touch upon the concepts. You can good to go. In this level, there's no easy escape. You know, it will all be easy and you have to do it from start to finish. So James Clerk Maxwell, who was he? Well, here he is. And in some rankings, he is number 17 of the greatest scientists ever lived. I read that there was a Millennium Poll in 2000 where the greatest physicists and scientists and mathematicians were asked about the biggest heroes in science. Maxwell came in at 3, just after Newton and Einstein. So this is an important piece of the puzzle and a very famous person. He wrote something called The Physical Lines of Force, which was a publication. Here you see it. And it had 4 parts. I'm not going to dive in all the 4 parts, but especially part number 3 will come up later when we look at his equations. And you might say, okay, that's just a scientific publication. Whatever. No. This publication is being considered as one of the most significant publications in physics and science ever. It is being compared with 2 other publications. Newton, I talked about Newton, he's not on our mountain, but because he is the greatest scientist of all, I keep pulling Newton into the slides. And he, well, he developed a big piece of math. And of course, Einstein with his four papers in 1905, which we will cover in future levels. So these three publications turned our world upside down and changed everything. I mean, really, these people had you can't even measure it. They had so much impact on humanity, on our planet, on everything. It's unbelievable. The good news is that it's four equations, Maxwell's equations, and most of them we have already covered. So I'm going to quickly summarize them and refer you back to the different levels in which they were treated. So the first one is just Gauss's law, which we dealt with at level 8, his law on electric flux. Short summary, we took Coulomb's law on the electrostatic force in level 6, and we talked about how we can look at this formula, this physical phenomena, in a different way by looking at something called electric fields. If you remember Q2, he got selfish, narcissism kicked in, megalomania kicked in, and then all the charges in the universe had a secret meeting, and they kicked out Q2, and all we had left was E, the electric field being generated by charge number one, Q1. And this was a major achievement to go from the left to the right paradigm, and it took the greatest over 162 years or so to make this change in perception. And then from then on, we were talking about fields, in this case, the electric field. So how did it look in words? In words, it was said that the net electric flux of a hypothetical closed surface is the same as some constant times the charges in that surface. And I made animations, and I'm going to show you the animations again. So here we have four charges. Two red ones, they have a positive charge, and two blue ones, they have a negative charge. And I have surrounded these charges with a hypothetical closed surface. And as said in other levels, I did not pick a perfect cube or perfect sphere. I picked a really strange burp cage on purpose. If we spin it, it looked like this. And then we went into we zoomed in on the surface of this imaginary hypothetical closed surface. And we looked at a single patch. Let's see. Here it is. And we talked about the blue factor. The blue factor is the resulting electric field at that patch. And that electric field results from the four charges within the birdcage. We talked about the red factor, which is a surface normal. It has a length of one and is perpendicular to the patch. And we talked about the concept of flux. I did not repeat all those animations in here, but in level 8 you can dive into the concept of flux. And if you would take the dot product, which was dealt with, I think, in level 7, between these two vectors, you get a little bit of flux. And if you do this for every patch of the birdcage and you add them all together, you can tell how much charge is in the birdcage. So it's actually looking through walls, not going into the cage, only on the surface, blindfolded, add stuff together, and it will tell you how much was in the cage. This was really magic. And in math form, it was like this. And for now, you don't have to remember this or go back to that level. All you have to remember is you can tell how many charges are within a volume by just doing stuff on the outside. Another way of representing the same phenomena with different math is using the concept of divergence from level 7 with the secret NAPLA symbol and the dot product and the vector fields level number 2, and it says that the divergence of the electric field equals the charge density, so Coulomb per cubic meter, divided by some constant, and in this case it was the electric constant. And that's what I asked you to remember. If you have charges, you have divergence, they've divergent electric field. So, and to visualize it, if you have all kinds of charges, they radiate some secret electric field into space. And that was it. Number two. Number two is new. Almost new. We didn't cover this from a math point of view, but we did cover this from a conceptual point of view. I showed you timelines about all the major discoveries. And one of those discoveries was that the Earth itself is a big magnet with the South Pole at the North Pole. Why? Why? You know, I don't know. But there it is. And this law was really difficult to research. I can't put a date on it. And people are not in agreement who did it. So that's why it's always also called the no one's law or the no monopole law. Some would say it's Gauss's law, the one for the electric field, but then for the magnetic field. But you know, we can also say Coulomb, you know, when we looked at the timeline in the previous level in 1785, he tried to cut the South Pole and the North Pole away from each other, but he ended up with two magnets again. And that's what this is about. You can't separate North from South. A magnet will always be the combination of the two. So this is what we would say in normal language. You can't chop off the North of the South Pole. So if you have a magnet and you cut it in two, you end up with two little magnets again. And that's Maxwell's second equation. And you can, of course, express this in math as well. But if you remember the concept, you're done. Mathematicians will do something like this. It's a bit like what we did with Gauss. You take the dot product, this in this case, not the electric field, but the magnetic field and the normal vectors around some surface, a hypothetical surface, around the magnet. And you will find that the flux in the end will be zero. So what does that mean? That means that the magnetic field lines going out through this hypothetical surface are the same as the ones going in. So stuff is going out on the North Pole end of the magnet. It curls back and comes back in at the south. So no magnetism is, no flux is being created or vanished. But they compensate each other. Which is really different from the electric flux, because if we have a single charge, it just radiates electric an electric field, that's divergence. But a magnet, it goes in, and it goes out, and it comes back in. And this is why it's zero. Stuff that goes out is the same as stuff that goes in. And a much nicer way to use to write this formula down is saying that the divergence, level number 7, with the dot product of the magnetic field is zero. And that is his second law. Number 3. Ha! Good news. We've already covered level 3 in the previous level, level number 10, when we talked about Faraday's law of induction. I do want to repeat the animation. I talked about the bar magnet with its magnetic field. And there is a yellow curved electric wire, metal wire, with blue electrons in them. And as soon as the magnet goes through the loop, it will create a curly electric field, making the electrons move. And moving electrons in a wire create curly magnetic fields, right? Because that was what we learned from Ørsted in the level, I think, number 9. So this is how it looks. The magnet goes in, oh no, the electrons start spinning and they say, no, go away. We don't like the change. We want to make things static. We don't like change. So if the magnet moves out, they are screaming, come back in, don't go. But if the situation is like this and it comes to you, say, no, go away. We don't like change. We want to have a stable situation. So the yellow magnetic field is trying to compensate for the green magnetic field that's going through the loop. And that's what the law of induction was from Faraday. And we discussed how to write it down, and we had two ways of writing it down, and these were the ones. I'm not going to repeat level 10 all over again, but if you have a changing magnetic field, like the bar magnet with its going through the loop, so the loop experiences changing magnetic fields, then you will get curly electric fields. And curly electric fields will make electrons that are able to run, and running electrons will create spinning magnetic fields trying to push back the change. That was law number 3. And here we have the units of measurement and the flux and the EMF, the electric motive force. Law number 4. Also, good news. Oh no, I'm way ahead of myself. So, changing magnetic field 1 gives curly electric field. Curly electric field makes electron spin, which is current in the wire, and they produce a curly magnetic field 2, which tries to compensate the change which was caused by magnetic field number 1. Number 4. Well, number 4 also, we already saw a big piece of number 4. When we looked at Ørsted said that if you have a current going through a wire, there will be a curly magnetic field around that wire. We made this animation, right? Does it animate? Yeah. So the blue electrons are running down the wire, which means that the electric current is the other way. I don't know why physicists chose this. Maybe because the electrons have a negative charge, but the electrons are running from right to left, and then the physicists say the current is going from left to right, which makes no sense, of course, but you know, I'm not a physicist. And when this happens, then we get a curly green B field. B for the magnetic field, which is circular, perpendicular, etc. In level 9, we discussed all the implications, and we talked about how to write this down, and it was like this line integral, which we fully explained. Yeah, we broke down every piece, but a much nicer way to write this down is the way Maxwell did it. Well, I don't think he did it, but you know, the way we today write down Maxwell's equations is that curly magnetic field, which is the Napla, the cross product, just means curl. Curly magnetic fields equals charge, current density in this case. And density is just, the current density is just the same as the I, which is the current divided by the surface area of the wire, the cross section. So there we go. And the constant is called the magnetic constant. And I told you a little bit about that constant as well in other levels. So this is the recap plus law number 2. But now, open your eyes, put away your phones. This is where it gets really, really interesting. Because Maxwell looked at those equations, he brought them together, and he was missing some kind of symmetry. He did the same thing as others did, and he gets closer and closer of the big secret, and then lightning strikes in 62, and he added this thing, the displacement current, to equation number 4. Don't panic. What it says is, if you have a changing electric field, it will produce a curly magnetic field, which is symmetry, you know, because we already saw that a curly magnetic field goes with, the change of the magnetic field goes with curly magnetism. Right? And this is just the other way around. So it's more symmetrical. And this, yeah, it's hard to put words on how significant this was. But this was really significant, you know. This is like finding the secret of the universe. It was unbelievable. So here we have the constants again. So in summary, on one slide, and I used the modern math, which was not from Maxwell, but from Heaviside. Number one, charges, electric charges, either radiate an electric field, and when they are negatively charged, the field lines of the electric field are inwards. Law number two, you can't cut a magnet into a separate north pole and south pole. Law number three, if you change the magnetic field, you will get curly electric field. Law number four, a steady current through a wire will produce curly magnetic fields. And if you change the electric field, you get a curly magnetic field back. And that's it. I mean, if you can follow this conceptually without even the math, you're good to go on Einstein's mountain. In math, it looks like this. These are Maxwell's equations. Very, very famous four equations. And we will now talk about its significance. So how cool are they? Let's see. Einstein. The most profound and the most fruitful that physics has experienced since the time of Newton are Maxwell's equations. Just think about it. Einstein saying that we had Newton and then we had Maxwell. This is not just a compliment, right? This is recognition. This is appreciation. Richard Feynman, also a well-known scientist, he made it even stronger. He said, if we look back, let's say 10,000 years from now, imagine 10,000 is a long time, there can be little doubt that the most significant event in the 19th century will be the four laws of Maxwell, Maxwell's equations. Think about it. You zoom out 10,000 years, you go to the future, and you look at the whole 19th century in which like a gazillion things happened, and he says, we will pick Maxwell's equations as the most significant event. I'm just quiet. Carl Sagan, one of my heroes, we will meet him in future levels. He made it like this. You see, they are struggling. I mean, there are just no words for this accomplishment. But he said they had greater impact on human history than any 10 presidents together. And I think he's right. So let me go one step back. Let's do this. So basically, in normal life, one of my friends reviews my video sometimes, and he always asks, what does this do for me, Tom, in normal life? Does it make it easier, cheaper, or more fun? Which is often, it's a very good question, not always easy to answer. But in this case, I would say, well, everything you use in daily life that runs on a battery or some kind of power couldn't be there without these four equations. And that's it. So to give you a view, if you break your arm and you go to the hospital to get an x-ray, thank Maxwell. If you put some food in your microwave and you heat it, once you finish the meal, thank Maxwell. The same if you get something cold from the fridge. Thank Maxwell. If you listen to the radio or watch television, thank Maxwell. If you're using the internet, thank Maxwell. And if you are still not convinced about what these four equations made possible, Wi-Fi wouldn't be there without these four equations. These equations are, we should have a statue of them, you know, in pure gold. I know some people have tattooed these equations on their body. I think that's a little bit over the top, right? You could just take a picture of them and put it in your room and thank him. Like every day when you use your cell phone, thank you, Maxwell. When you go to the fridge, thank you, Maxwell. You could do that, right? So, but, you know, it's It's just beautiful. It's beauty in its essence. And I think that's it, right? Yeah, that's it. So let me go back. So this is Maxwell's equations. If you were new to this episode and you haven't seen any of the other levels, this was pretty quick. All the levels dive in way more than I did just now on the individual elements, including all the mathematical building blocks. If you start at level 2, you will learn the building blocks and you will be able to read these equations just like it's normal language. I really want to thank you if you made it all the way up until this level. As said, enjoy the view, relax before we move on. Because then we will talk about a whole new topic. This was all about magnetism and electricity. Next level, we go into a new chapter of physics. Thank you and see you at level number 12. GP, hit it!